Hello, welcome back to Let's Play, interactively play Steve Jackson's Sorcery. This is a Let's Play. We get to choose at the end of the video what choice you would like to make, you know, as of the next video going forward. Last time, unfortunately, we had a three-way tie. We're here in this building. There were actually, I think this represents it, two entrances, one here, but we see another one back here. I'm not sure what's going on with that. But one had a sign with a tooth or teeth on it. Another one had a sign with tongs. So we've not gone into the tongs building yet. Hope we still can. Or entrance, rather. As far as the teeth, we did go in there, and the guy was selling Snatticat teeth, of which we have three. Firefox teeth, of which we have three. And I think stone golem teeth? I'm not completely sure. They're very expensive. And so we don't buy those because they're pretty expensive. You can summon a creature, you can summon a Snatticat or a stone golem or whatever the hell it is. But for some reason, Firefox, you can only summon a flame, not a Firefox. Oh well. So of course we didn't buy any of that stuff. And so we're getting an option to sell our own teeth. I would like to sell a few of the teeth that we have in our inventory, possibly, but if we sell our own tooth, we might not have to. So, how much for a molar? For one of yours, well, he sighs a happy sigh, I would say 30 gold pieces at least. You're strong and intelligent. I can see that much from the curve of your incisors. You can tell that from my incisors. Would that seem fair to you? Now, I had one person vote to sell a tooth. I had one person vote to upsell. That is not enough. And another person vote to say my teeth are not for sale. So we have a three-way tie, so now I'm going to have to break to the die rolling section and roll a die to see what option we're going to take here. Okay, here we are again, rolling a four-sided die to determine, well, number one, sell a tooth. Number two, that is not enough. I'm trying to upsell him. Three, my teeth are not for sale. Or four, we get a reroll. So let's see what we get. One. Selling a tooth. Yay, that's actually kind of what I hope for. Okay. So we're selling a tooth. Does it hurt? It's probably going to take away some stamina, right? I don't imagine they have any numbing agents? The man beams with pleasure and counts out 30 gold pieces, which he places in a stack on a low table next to a pair of iron tongs. Then he stands from his chair and gestures for you to sit down. Now the other entrance was tongs. Maybe it is all his building and the tongs is for this. Well, I'm not going to snatch the money and run. I'm not going to change my mind because our vote has been cast. Or, well, not our vote. The roll has been cast. So we're going to sit. Yep, it took away three stamina. Look at that. I don't have the gold yet, I notice. Nervously, you lower yourself into the chair. The merchant locks one door and then the other. Oh, he has both doors. Now, he says, please don't scream too loudly, or my neighbors will complain. Nice. You got any... I forget what it's called. I can't remember the name of the medicine. I hate when I can't remember things. It's on the tip of my tongue. They give you a needle, but right into your gum, which I hate, but is admittedly not as bad as feeling it all. But I don't imagine they have that in this day and age. What follows is protracted and painful. The man puts one foot up on the armrest of the chair to gain enough leverage, oh my god, and then shoves the tongue so deep into your mouth that you gag. Yeah, I believe it. Then, with a combination of yanking, twisting, tugging, and hammering, good god, he finally draws the tooth from your gum with a sickening squelch. You are left sweating and dizzy. Your tooth disappears into the back room. Well, I'm dizzy, so let me wait a moment. This is the worst dentist visit ever. I'm going to be so thankful for, you know, the needle you get at the dentist from now on. My god. I can only imagine back then. Let's wait. Ooh, look at that. 43 gold. Woo! We have never had so much gold. Never, ever. You gasp and try to recover your strength. Do you have anything more to sell? He asks as he presses a towel to your bleeding tooth and drops the money into your pouch. I have teeth as well. I don't know. I don't want to sell them all. You tell him through thick lips. And from what creature? I really want to sell them all. I don't know how to summon a snat-a-cat. Snaff-a-calf. Fifox. Triumph. Yeah, I'll tell him snaff-a-calf. I don't want to sell them all, but I don't know if we're going to have the option. His eyes light up. A most useful tooth indeed, he exclaims, and very hard to come by. I will give you 8 gold pieces per tooth. I hope that is acceptable. Huh. Should I take a chance? Try to upsell him? I might offend him. He might not buy them all. That is too little. 10 then. But I cannot go higher. I'm going to sell 2. Whoa. Nice. We... I can't believe we have 63 gold, guys. Yep. You guys who have been watching, like... You guys know I've been, like, poor this entire playthrough. The most I've had is, like... Like, maybe 31, 32, something like that. I'm actually curious now and go back to way back. It was before, probably back in the first episode, the first chapter. Because we lost a lot of money, I think, in the city of Kari. We ended up buying stuff and we got pickpocketed quite a bit. 15 gold, I believe, we lost in that fair. The carnival, whatever the hell it was. Alright. You take out 2 teeth and hand them over. The merchant whistles for a lackey who takes them into a back room and returns with 20 gold pieces. Anything else? He asks. Well, I'm keeping my giant tooth. We can also use the tinderbox, right? I'm thinking in place of the firefox teeth, but I'm going to sell 1 firefox tooth because, number one, I might need them, right? The tinderbox might be used up. I don't know. I want to cook this meat, right? Maybe we need more than one lighting implement. You know, maybe we need to light a couple fires to cook this whole thing. I don't know. So, really, just because I have a lot of money now. So I'm going to sell 1 firefox tooth. Hopefully we have the same option. Fifoff. He considers for a moment, sucking at his cheeks, then shakes his head. I have one already, and they do not sell well, he replies. Firefoxes are admittedly of limited use. Most people prefer a simple fire spell to snapping a tooth. He shrugs apologetically. No more? He asks. Do I have a giant tooth? I thought I didn't have one. I thought I used that up. Let me look. Magical item? Oh, I do have a giant's tooth. Well, I'm kind of curious to see what he would say and react, but I'm kind of... Yeah, I'm worried that it would just automatically sell it without prompting me, so I'm going to sell nothing. You close your pack. I have nothing more for off of you. Why would I... Just out of curiosity, why would I cast a spell at this point? Huh. You open your arms to raise a spell, but the merchant catches your arm. Try if you must, he says, but we have a mini-mite chained up in the back room. We don't want people testing out the merchandise in the shop, you understand? Huh. Alright. I can see that. I can see them doing that, like, all over. Poor mini-mites. I can see them being very useful in that regard, just in general, to stop people from casting spells, right? Because spells are really dangerous. Perhaps I will buy something after all. He squints as he tries to understand you, then nods. Oh, rock demon, that's what it is. He squints as he tries to understand you, then nods. What would you like? Yeah, nothing. You know, I'm tempted to kind of buy the rock demon tooth. What do you guys think? It's just it's half my gold, and I've never had this much, and maybe I can buy a new sword or some armor or something like that. I might need this gold for something. And I don't know a spell for a rock demon. I would have to also learn the spell. Maybe I should wait until I learn the spell, or if I learn the spell, and then maybe I can come back here. All right? So let's buy nothing more. You peruse his stock once more, but do not find anything to buy. There's nothing more to do here. With a final glare at the man and his horrendous chair, you return to the street. Shudders. I'm shuddering. Your mouth is still aching and throbbing, but perhaps a little less than before. You kidding me? This will last for at least 24 hours. You move along. The streets are quieter here, with fewer passers-by, but there are still no guards, no soldiers, no priests, no children playing. It's as though this whole city is purely a place of workers and foremen. A mining town. That was what the dentist had said. Telling it like it is, he's a dentist. Novocaine. That's the word I was trying to think of. Novocaine. No novocaine in these ages. You'd think they'd have a magic spell, like, instead. Alright. I'm guessing we can't aim this any higher. What if I aim it this way? You return to the tower. As you walk, the buildings crumble, their walls caving in, sand pouring like water from doorways and filling the empty streets. One by one, the people turn corners and disappear. That's sad, but, you know, it's the passage of time. The gloomy shade of the tower encompasses you. You could return up to the tower or back out into the street. We'll go up to the tower. The movable cylinder waits on its rail. So just a beam. I don't suppose this is... There's going to be anything there, so... Let's turn it... Right. See that? There's a town. There's a fishing town or something. I've reached the edge of the screen. I'm going to move... The serpent is there? The serpent is not there. What's the X? The X is where I defeated that serpent, I think? The earth serpent? So let's go... Just make sure I get it all here. I want to visit that fishing village. It's probably what it is. You shift the brass cylinder, then step back to regard its effects. And then we climb down. You turn down the tower steps. And actually move my character. And, yeah. You leave the tower base. The sun continues to climb the steep sky. The silence of the city is a sudden shock once more. All the people you saw earlier, all have disappeared like sunlight behind a cloud. There must be something, huh? Let's return to the road. You leave the city by the old road. The sun has reached its highest point now. Out of the shade, the air is baking hot. This is not a place to linger. Well, then let's return into the more verdant area of the past. The road curves gently as you follow it. You begin to hear the distant sound of chatter and cartwheels on the stone. The sun is beginning to lower. The air begins to cool. The road begins to bustle with people who seem to emerge through the dust and mist and rumble past in their carts. I will look at them. Of all the strange things you have seen out in the waste, this is the strangest. These people come from nowhere and go nowhere, and the same travelers pass by again and again, waving the same greetings down to you. You stride on through the crowds. After a few minutes, you encounter a small girl sitting on her own and staring into the distance. Look for her parents. You pause to look about for her parents. The girl cannot be more than 5 years old, but there are no adults nearby, only the occasional traveler making their way along the moonlit road. The girl looks up at you sharply. "You're in the wrong place," she says. "Aren't you?"
"Hmm. What do you mean?"
"I can see it," she says. "No one else seems to notice, but I can see it."
"What can you see?"
I'm curious. "I think it must be a curse," she replies thoughtfully. "Adults are so forgetful. They forget everything."
"Well, she's not mad. She sees them from another time. I do not understand. I want her to say more about this."
She points up the road toward a great stone arch at the entrance to the city. "When did they rebuild that?" she asks.
"I have seen that arch broken,"
you tell her. She nods. "I knew it. Didn't I say? You're in the wrong place. I could tell by the way you were looking at people. Are you the one who stole my parents?"
"No." "I don't know,"
you tell her. She shakes her head, then stands abruptly, hitting you.
"Ah!
I think you are. I can tell you are. No one else can see it, but you can. It was you, and I want them back." With that, she rushes away and is quickly lost in the strange mists. All is quiet once more.
"Well, crap, I'd love to find your parents."
"Which way did she go?"
"This way? Before I head onward towards the fishing village, let me just head back here, see if she ran this way."
"No." You follow the old road. The surface begins to crack underfoot. Weeds break through as the stones crack. Soon the roadway is lost under a layer of fine dust. Slowly the sun begins to make its way back down the sky. Time to move onwards. Well, she's not here because she ran out of her time. So let's go back. You'll need to sleep soon. The road curves gently as you follow it. The sun lowers toward the horizon. You stride along the road. No one stops to talk to you. South. You continue following the road. The sun is now in the lowest quarter of the sky. It will be night soon. The road is busy as before. You stride on. The lake shore. Okay. Excellent. Hope I can buy some food here. Some fish? Rations? You follow the food as it curves and bends and finally begins to descend until it reaches the shores of the lake. All around is hustle and bustle. The area above the shore teems with stalls and shoppers, and at the waterline, fishermen tend their boats, punting them out into the water. In the distance, you can make out a tall tower rising from one of the lake's many islands. Darkness closes in. You need to rest, especially after going all day without eating.
"I want food, man. I'll rest."
The stallholders and fishermen pack away, departing the shoreline in all directions and disappearing from view as they leave the light from the distant beacon. Soon you are quite alone. Let me look across the water. You walk down to the edge of the water and look out southwards. The surface is almost mirror flat, the reflection of the moon broken only by the occasional ripple. Familiar stars seem to lie on the ground, their patterns visible to all. Look at the stars. The stars on the water are laid out like a chart, but a chart in reverse. Looking at them like this reminds you of what Bria the sorceress said, of spells having opposites. In the water, constellations you recognize above become others below.
No, I have not. I'm wondering if these spells can be useful. The law spell is Charm Animal. The Zap spell is Lightning Bolt. And the SUS spell, Sus, whatever, is Detect Trap or something like that. I'm not sure exactly. Yeah, Detect Trap. Best action for it to be, you know, best protective action to take.
So if someone's gonna throw a spell at me, I'm not an animal, so it wouldn't really work on me. Detect Trap, you know, but if someone threw a lightning bolt at me, it would be really helpful to be able to
hurl a counterspell and deflect that, or, you know, something to that effect. Cool. You glance across the water, identifying the reflection of the stars by the zap spell. In the water, the constellation of Zen is formed. Perhaps the spell of lightning is negated by that of levitation? You've learned a new counterspell. A gentle breeze begins to pick up. Okay, we've been replaced by the gum spell. We have the other two still there. Gum is what? Is that like a web kind of sticky spell, I think? Yeah, web spell. Okay. That's another thing that could be cast at me, offensive spell. Next, you find the image of the gum spell, whose stars form the shape of the zip spell. It would seem the magic of gluing counters the pattern of teleportation. Hmm. The surface of the water starts to ripple and break. Okay. Is that dragon coming? I thought they were only in the present. I'm in the past now. What about the lost spell, yeah. Okay. I saw something coming my way. Closer to the shoreline lie the stars of the lost spell. The new shape matches the mag spell. Incredible. The spell of control is countered by that of magical protection. Remember, counterspells are recorded in your spellbook. Suddenly, the waters smash open as an enormous creature bursts up from below. It has three racks of nightmarish teeth, and they are open and coming your way. Well, I could run. I could just wait. I'd throw my sword at it. I think I would lose my sword that way. I wouldn't want to run, because maybe we should be protecting this village. So that we can rest here and maybe buy some food, some fish. I love fish, guys, in real life. Just love fish. So let's cast some kind of spell. If this is a beastie, maybe I can cast the law spell. Nope. Damn it. There's no L. Alright, so I got Yap, which is talk to animals. Didn't seem very helpful last time I talked to it. I think I cast it on a bear, and it all it said was, you know, I want to eat you or something. Gak, cause fear. We do not have the black face mask. I think we had it one time. I think that was stolen or something. The gum is create glue. Do not have that. Is there any? Was there another GA? No. Alright, so fix. Fixedness. I don't have a staff of oak sapling. Not really a lot of choices here. Dim. Cause stupidity. So far I'm leaning at that. It's probably a stupid creature already though. We have lightning bolt. Zap. Anything else? No. I don't know. Should I cause stupidity in it or hurl a lightning bolt at it? It's in the water. The bad thing about the lightning bolt is it causes... three stamina. But the fact that it's in the water means it might... it might be freaking devastating. I don't know. I'm thinking it's most likely a stupid creature already. I'm not even sure. So, let me cast Create Lightning. You gather the constellations into order around you, winding a powerful electric force in your hand. Then you fire the bolt into the water. There's a terrible cracking, and then the fish floats to the surface, its flesh gently smoking. It's a fish? An enormous creature with three racks of... okay. I guess it can be enormous. Let's cut away some fish. Hell to the yes. Oh, I got stamina back. You wait for the last I'm like maxed out again. I'm so happy. You wait for the last flickers of lightning to fade, then stride into the shallows and cut away some of the fish for your with your longsword. It is meaty, succulent, and only slightly burnt. Why did I gain stamina back? From going into the water? Oh, I ate some of it. I guess I ate some of it? Take some as provisions. Alright, I guess I ate some and I'm gonna either leave the rest or take provisions. I'm gonna take provisions. Two rations! Look how good I'm doing now, guys. I'm so happy right now. I am full stamina, 63 gold, and two rations. We have not been doing this well in a long time. I am so glad. The fish meat is smoked enough that it should keep for a few days. You cut away two meals worth and store them. You leave the rest of the smoking body of the gigantic fish to bob away on the lake's current. A few things growl in the bushes near the shoreline. Alright, well, don't know about bushes. Let's look through the rubbish piles. Are those near the bushes? I'm gonna look through the rubbish piles. Without any thought to the smell, you dig through one of the nearby piles of fish heads, roly-poly fish heads, scales, bones, and other body bits from the day's catches. At the bottom of the heap, you find a single gold piece, which hardly seems worth the smell and oil that now covers your fingers. Well, we've made it even 64. The Commodore 64, 64K out of this. So, hey, one more gold piece. One more for the pile. So happy. Let's find somewhere to rest. Looking across the water, you have a strong sense of how far you still have to go. You cannot hope to swim across, so there is no progress to be made now. I actually really don't need to sleep, but if time passes, we can, you know, talk to people and, you know, I'll wake up in the morning, they'll wake up, and there'll be stuff to do, right? Let's sleep in a stall. Seems the most safe, right? There's stuff in the water, there's stuff in the bushes, let's sleep in a stall. You find an open market stall and lie down under the shelter if it's canopied roof. It smells of fish, but the walls should keep any animals at bay. Unstrapping your pack on the shore of the lake, you try to stretch out despite the wind. At least you have eaten once already today. I don't need to eat anything more. I'm good. I'm maxed out. Unless it's going to max out my hit points, and I don't think it will. I now missed the time when I used to have 20 hit points. That was nice. Close my eyes. You stretch out and rest. You seem left alone here, and your night is untroubled by dreams. Yay. The lake shore, day 21. During the past day, you gained some provisions, plus 2, and a huge amount of gold, plus 51, and found no new clues. Although we did figure out some counterspells. Gotta give me that one. The sun rises, bringing with it chatter and excitement, as stallholders and fishermen begin to gather at the shoreline. The sun has not yet crested the last peaks in the east. Now I'm thinking, yeah, buy some more rations. Shouldn't be too expensive. We have plenty of gold. Maybe could find some armor, and a better sword. Let's check out my weapons. Still plus 2 longsword. I wonder if we could sell this stuff. Yeah. I think we're done with the foliage, unfortunately. So let's go to the stalls. On the other side of the bay area, from the waterfront, is a line of stalls. Most sell food, grilled fish and fruit, though there is also a bottle seller selling stoppered bottles. We have fish already. Let me see if I can look at this stuff. Two joints of meat. Raw meat, empty water gourd. That's a lake? I should be able to fill that at the lake, right? The water gourd? Guessing not salt water? I don't know. So we have fish already. Let's visit the fruit cellar and then let's go check out these bottles. What should I buy? Let's check the bottles first. These are going to be more expensive and I can pad it out with some food, right? Some bottles.
You stop at the bottle seller's stall. He has shelves and shelves of bottles of all different shapes and sizes and colors. A few are filled, but most are empty. You greet the bottle seller.
Look at the filled bottles.
You scan over the filled bottles. Most seem to contain nothing but colored water and are probably filled simply to show off the craftsmanship of the glass. But a rack at the front appears to contain blimberry potion, and the row behind is labeled Holy Water from the Temple of the Mule.
Let me look at the empty bottles before I ask about anything.
You look over the man's collection of empty bottles. They come in every size, from that of your thumb up to tankards as large as your thigh. There are thin bottles and portly bottles and bottles in every shade of colored glass. Some twist and corkscrew. Some are delicately fluted. Most are very well made indeed.
Let me ask about the bottles.
You have a lot of bottles here, you remark. The bottle seller smiles. It is not my passion, if that is what you mean, but I am very, very good at making bottles, as you can see.
Let me look at the blimberry potion. I know... I think the holy water works best with that spell. The, healing spell. Let me see. Because that's actually a reagent of that spell. I'm trying to see if I can find it here. Oh, resurrection. We have a resurrection spell to use with holy water. If you drink them, they heal you, but I guess... Yeah. Yeah, that's it. Okay. I wonder who we'd want to resurrect. I know this is going to be... We're going to need this at some point. Buy blimberry potion. Kind of acts as, like, backup rations. Although, I want to see how much they are.
Blimberry potions, the vendor says. The finest, sourced from the wet marsh of Lake Lumley itself. 7 gold pieces each.
That's very expensive.
You observe. It's not entirely the cost of the liquid, he answers. The bottle is highest quality as well.
Hmm. So 14, let's buy 2.
I'll take 2, you tell him. He hands them over carefully. Be careful of the glass, he says.
Okay, what about the holy water?
Holy water is most valuable, the hawker says. An excellent wedding present, for example, and good for magic. Hence the high craftsmanship of the glass. 10 gold pieces. Now I think we might have some, actually. I do have 1. I'm pretty sure I drank one. It didn't give me back that many, you know, hit points. So I might save that 1 for resurrecting. In case we have to resurrect anybody. I can't imagine we'd have to resurrect an entire group of people. We might never have to resurrect anyone. So I'm going to not buy them. I'm going to not buy and use the blimberry potions and the food for restoring your points. So let's go don't buy. You smile and shake your head. Bid farewell. You bid farewell to the bottle seller.
Let's go visit the fruit seller.
You greet the fruit seller, who waves his hand across his selection. 1 apple, 2 gold pieces, he declares. Finest Zanzunu apples.
Alright, let's buy some fruit.
I'll buy some apples, you tell the hawker.
How many? He nods.
I'll buy 2. That's 4 gold to you. The man replies, accepting your coins. You put the fruit into your pack.
Okay, let's visit the fishmonger.
The fishmonger is a large woman who wields an enormous cleaver. I'll chop it and grill it for you, she announces. 4 gold pieces per head. This one's bigger than the rest, the woman advises you, pointing at one of the fish in particular. But the difference is not discernible to your eye.
Four gold pieces. Okay. Fish heads? Do we eat the thing's brain and eyes too? Let's buy it. You pay the woman four gold pieces, and she slaps a fish onto her griddle, squeeze it over the lemon. That's a plus. Throws on a couple of unlikely looking herbs and lets it fry. After a few minutes and a smell that makes your stomach ache with hunger. I'm full. I'm fine. She slides the cooked fish off the griddle and onto some thick cheesecloth for carrying. The skin is so hot it makes your fingers blister to touch. Let's save the fish. I'm guessing these things don't go bad. You place the fish wrapped in thin paper into your pack to eat later. You move away from the stalls. The early morning sun makes the air glow. Okay. Look at us, guys. Frickin' look at us. Now watch someone pickpocket almost all my gold and take my food and almost kill me. Let's go to the shore once again. I'm not sure where else to go. Maybe I can hire a boat. You walk down to the shoreline. The water looks clean and inviting, though it is almost certainly freezing cold. In the far distance, boats punt this way and that between scattered islands. Blow the whistle. What whistle? I have a whistle? Let me look. I don't remember. Regular items? This whistle. Oh. A simple brass whistle. If I ever knew what it was for, I've forgotten. Huh. So anyway, yeah, I'm going to leave this for a vote here. I'm not going to step away from the water is not included in the vote, so if you choose that, you're effectively abstaining, because I really don't know where anywhere else to go at this point. I mean, it doesn't look like we can cross this. So, yeah, what do you think? What do you guys think we should do? Should we just swim across the lake, which is certainly freezing cold? Should I call out for a boat, which kind of makes sense for me, is what I choose. And, or should we blow the whistle, which I do not know what effect that has. Maybe you guys have an idea or remember or know what the whistle's for. So let me know what you guys think. Should we swim across the lake, call out for a boat, or blow the whistle? Thanks so much for watching, guys. Thanks for voting. And endure and enduring. Grow strong. See you next week.